It's the weekend, and you have financial questions that need answering. That can only mean one thing. It's time for Jill on Money, the show that takes the mystery out of your finances. Here's your host, Jill Schlesinger.
Welcome to Jill on Money. We are delighted that you are joining us. My gosh, it's like if it's not a hurricane of a actual event, it is a hurricane of a data breach. Last week, we did hear about the Category 5 storm called the Equifax security breach. And I just got inundated with calls and emails and worries. And, you know, we always worry about these things after the fact, of course, right? Because that's where human beings, I get that. But if you have not done so, go on over to the Equifax emergency website, EquifaxSecurity2017.com. You want to determine whether or not you've been compromised, considering that 143 million people were compromised. Chances are you've got better than 50-50 shot that you were compromised. And so many issues around this, but perhaps one of the most important is that you've really got to take matters into your own hands, because this protection service that Equifax has people enrolled in, first of all, it's only for Equifax. You only get it free for 1 year. Your liability is probably going to last longer. And so, you know, as John Alzheimer says, he's been a guest on this show many times. If this protection is only applying to your Equifax report and not your credit reports at Experian and TransUnion, he says, quote, it's like locking one of the three doors to your house. So please, if you've got questions, if you want to know what to do, go to the website, go to JillOnMoney.com. We'll put it in the show notes, but we've got a bunch of different steps to take. Obviously, it's really important to have a fraud alert on your credit report. You don't have to do that at Equifax. You can do it at Experian or TransUnion. But also, really do consider putting a credit freeze on your credit file. That stops all access to your credit report, unfortunately. Yeah, you got to talk to each company independently to freeze your file. Some states charge a fee for freezing and unfreezing. And if you yourself need credit, need to open a new, start a relationship, maybe because you're getting an auto loan, you're getting a student loan or a parent loan for your kids or a mortgage, you have to unfreeze that account. But please, please take this seriously. It is a big deal. Just go to JillOnMoney.com. You can just search Equifax data breach, what to do, Jill on Money, and there it will be. All right. I'm really so bummed about this whole thing. What a pain in the neck for everybody. But that said, I was a little downbeat on that, huh, Mark? I was a little negative. Let's be happy. Let us be happy and tell you that there are many things that you need to be doing right now to take advantage of your various aspects of your financial life and doing what's best for you. The first thing you can do is give us a call, 855-411-JILL. That's what Dave from Arizona has done. So, Dave, welcome to Jill on Money. How can we help you?
Hey, Jill. Hey, I talked to you a couple of years ago and took your advice on a couple of things.
Great.
And I just retired the beginning of this year.
Congratulations.
And believe it or not, our union and our company helps us with some financial planning. And I did a quick look-see of what I had. And what they came up with, that I had saved too much in retirement.
You saved too much. What's wrong? You're sad you have to pay taxes? Poor baby.
Well, that's part of the problem. I have a couple of different retirements from the military, Social Security, and my company.
Mm-hmm.
And they said I'm going to run into a big tax problem once I start taking my minimum distributions in basically about 5 years.
Okay. How old are you, Dave?
I'm 65 and a half.
Okay.
So I'm looking at 70 and a half, about 5 years.
Right. How much money is in all of those accounts that have not yet been taxed? Your traditional either IRA, 401k, 403b?
Well, between the 401k, IRA that is non-Roth, and deferred annuities, I got about $2.2 million.
Yeah, that's a lot of money, dude.
But, yeah.
And there's no way to make your age 70 go away. So is the complaint like, oh, I wish I had done something different? What's your fear right now?
Well, the fear right now, I'm delaying taking my Social Security until age 70.
Mm-hmm.
And I've talked to a couple of different people, and they've gone everything from annuities, which didn't make any sense, to tax harvesting my accounts that aren't producing, to even whole life, which I didn't understand how whole life is going to help me a lot.
Well, I mean, the problem is, no matter what you actually end up doing with the proceeds, you have to take the money out. And there's no getting around that. In other words, Uncle Sam has a rule. And that $2.2 million has to come out of the account. Now, are you single? Are you married? What's your story?
I'm single. I have one sibling, my sister, and she's about 6-7 years older than I am.
Mm-hmm.
So nope. I figure we're going to both go about the same time. So.
Uh-huh. No kids?
No kids.
Okay. I mean, all right, so let's talk about some things you could do. You could take that required minimum distribution and gift it to charity, right? You can do that charitable, which is, it may, you know, I don't know, are you into charity or not?
Well, let's put it this way. When I pass on, I just do not give it to the government. I'd rather give it to somebody that could make some good use of it.
Okay. So when you got your, when you get that, your required minimum distribution, about how much was the amount that looks like has to come out at 70 and a half? About how much of that 2.2?
It was about 80 to 100 grand.
So what, I mean, here's the thing. I know you can transfer. Here's one really good idea. When you're 70 and a half or older, you can transfer up to 100. So if you didn't need the money, you could transfer $100,000 tax-free each year to a charity. And that counts as your required minimum distribution, but it's not included in your adjusted gross income. Now, here's the difference. You pull the 100 grand out and you get taxed on it, you're still going to end up with some money, right? You're going to have some amount of money. But if you feel like you want to, you could transfer that, or some portion, not the whole thing, but you could transfer a bunch of it into a charity. And that's a really interesting possibility in terms of doing good, but also saying, well, you know, I want some of the money, but maybe not all. But it's really, it's kind of a cool thing. It does not count as taxable income if you direct that RMD or a portion of that RMD to a charity. So it has to go directly. That's very important. It cannot go to you and then to the charity. So hang on, Dave, because when we come back from the break, I want to see if that kind of is intriguing to you. If it's not, then maybe you're not. We'll have to think about something else. But we'll go through those other ideas. You're listening to Jill on Money, where it can be a problem to save too much. No, it's not a problem. It's all like a very good story. So hang on. We'll be talking to Dave from Arizona when we come back. If you'd like to come on the air, 855-411-JILL. Send us an email. Ask Jill at jillonmoney.com. We'll be right back.
It's Jill on Money with Jill Schlesinger. Have a question? Call or email anytime, 855-11-JILL, or ask Jill at jillonmoney.com.
You're back with Jill on Money. If you've got a financial question, we'd love to hear from you. Our phone number is 855-411-JILL. Send us an email, ask Jill at jillonmoney.com. We were talking with Dave from Arizona, who has like the best problem ever. He has saved a couple million bucks, which is fabulous. 2.2 million to be exact, but none of that money has been taxed yet. And that means that in 5 years, when Dave turns 70 and a half, a whole bunch of money has to come out of that account. Your required minimum distribution. Government wants to get paid, right? And so, Dave, what do you think about the idea of not taking the money and sending it off to charity. How do you feel about that?
I would just soon do something with that money and you know, have faith be something that would do good for other people.
That's, I mean, because I think that this is one of those weird things that this was a benefit that obviously is clearly for rich people, right? Because, you know, the government is not thinking that tons of people say, oh, I don't need all of my money. Most people need to live on the money that comes out of their required minimum distribution. But as you said, you don't really need it because you've got all this other income, right? You've got your Social Security and you've got pension and all of that's covered. So what I think would be interesting for you is to do a little bit of homework on this, but it essentially allows you to do this. And this is called a qualified charitable distribution, a QCD. And, you know, it was very confusing for a while. The problem was that this was like a year-to-year thing, but now it is actually a permanent benefit. And so last year or the year before? But anyway, this qualified charitable distribution is now 100% legit in the books. It's law. So I think what you need to start to consider is, number one, well, what kind of charity would I want to do this with? And you've got some time, right, because you have 5 years. But I think I would start doing my research now and starting to see whether this makes sense. And if you change your mind, you don't have to commit to it right now. But at the very least, this is a way for you to really feel good about the money you've saved. And, you know, the reason it works so beautifully is, again, because you are able to sidestep getting the taxable income. It doesn't matter whether that money goes to a charity. The charity never has to pay the tax, right, because it's a qualified 501c3. So one other thing, just again, I said this before the break, but the money must go directly from the retirement account to the charity for it to count as a tax-free transfer. So wherever are you going to roll your 401k into an IRA eventually?
Yeah.
So whoever is holding that IRA, whatever company is doing that, that administrator will have to be involved in this process. So just make sure of that. And I think that may be a really cool way for you to feel good about all this money and not feel like, oh man, all this money's going to the government. You'll feel like, this is so cool. All this money I saved, this will be amazing for some charity that I believe in.
That sounds good.
All right, man. No IRA. This is so good because now we don't have to look at an annuity, no life insurance, no nothing. Just do good.
That sounds good.
All right, Dave. Good luck.
Thanks.
Thanks so much for calling.
Bye-bye.
Bye. So good. I love that one. That's about as good as it gets, my friend. What do you mean you don't get? What's wrong? Mark doesn't get it. He goes, I don't get it. What is wrong with you? So Mark says, just pay the taxes and have fun with the money. Well, maybe this is like a more, but isn't it nice that he doesn't even have to pay that? I mean, yeah, he just doesn't want to give it to the government. So let him give it to a place where he feels good about it. But, you know, this is such a funny thing. When you are looking at your own financial life and you get so wrapped up in taxes and you lose sight of the fact that, oh my God, I've saved $2.2 million, which is completely amazing to me. And we really do drive ourselves crazy about money. I was just saying this to my pal Seth yesterday, as a matter of fact. And he was like, well, why is that? And I said, you know, remember when we interviewed the psychologist, Lisa Damore? I loved her. And she made it stuck with me. And she said, the reason we drive ourselves crazy about money is that it's like the easiest thing to drive ourselves crazy about rather than dealing with our emotions. It's so concrete, right? And so instead of dealing with like the real emotions around what's going on in your life, you make it this a concrete thing. And money becomes the repository of all of your emotional nuttiness. And so, you know, now maybe I'm going to make this guy feel better. He doesn't have to go to therapy. He doesn't have to pay the government the taxes, and he's going to pick a charity that I hope he picks a charity we like. I know. Well, Mark is pointing out that when you're saving in these accounts, you've got to remember that you're paying taxes. So, of course, that, you know, for every $1 million that you've put into that 401k or $100,000 or $10,000, just lop off a quarter of it. It's going to taxes. About. I'm giving you a little, you know, here and there. But, yeah, you're paying. Or use a Roth IRA, which is a way to make sure that this doesn't happen to you. We've had a lot of questions recently, Roths, and that's one of the great advantages of a Roth. You've already paid your taxes. I would never be worried about paying taxes on that money. Just not something that I would just really be kind of cool with it. I'm cool with that. Well, what can I say? A recent survey of 2,000 adults from the National Endowment for Financial Education found 53% of respondents believe financial education gets the best results in college, second only to high school instruction. So everyone wants financial education, but we're not doing it. So what's up? There are a bunch of colleges that are starting to actually do this, which is so cool. If your college of choice is not engaging in offering financial education programs, why don't you ask them why? As a parent, I think it's important to get your young adults to sign up for online courses by nonprofit organizations, not by some, you know, big financial service company. And if you're a school administrator, launch a program, will you? Come on. There's a really good one from the St. Louis Federal Reserve, which I love their tools. They're fantastic. But let's get our young people educated. I know just because you have financial education does not mean you're not going to screw up your life in some way, shape, or form. But give your kids a head start. Talk to them about this. Find out what's available. Get on board with this. What do we do here? Oh, I do that. Oh, Mark says I do that. I do that at CBS. I do a seminar with them. I get tons of questions. It's amazing. The financial literacy rate in the U.S. has not moved in the past 3 years, in case you were wondering. I don't understand that. And it's just, it's really is amazing that we can't figure out how, like, I don't know, we teach a lot of crap in these schools. It should be compulsory. I'm not saying that you're, like I said, financial education does not mean that you're going to be a successful investor or anything like that, but you have to take responsibility. No one's doing this. We've lost the ability to just sort of blame someone else. Now the cat's out of the bag, gang. We got to do it ourselves. So if you have a question and you want to gain some financial wisdom, why don't you give us a holler? 855-411-JILL. Send us an email, askjill@jillonmoney.com. And if you've missed any of our previous shows with some really terrific guests and you want to figure out what's going on, you can go to our YouTube channel. We link to it right at the top of the website. Go to jillonmoney.com. Top of the website, it says YouTube because Mark made that happen. And that we love. We love that about Mark for so many reasons. So give us a call. Stay in touch. Go to jillonmoney.com. Take responsibility. Educate. All that fun stuff. 855-411-JILL. Send us an email. askjill@jillonmoney.com. We'll be right back.
K, IRAs, refinancing. She covers it all. Back to Jill on Money with Jill Schlesinger. Broadway
is dark tonight. You're back with Jill on Money. This is the program that takes the mystery out of your financial life. I'm Jill Schlesinger, the senior CFP board ambassador. Mark, how's those new CFP classes going? What have you done so far? What's class number three? What is this? Investments. This is going to be your favorite one. You're going to be acing this one. Can't wait till you get this. It's going to be great. Then you're going to leave me. You're going to say, I don't want to be a producer. I want to be, I think I gave you the title of executive producer. I don't want to be an executive producer. I would much rather be a certified financial planner helping people every day and making way more money. He doubts it, but I don't believe it. I think he's going to want to do it. If you've got a financial question, we'd like to hear from you. 855-411-JILL. Send us an email, askjill@jillonmoney.com. I do want to tell you that we got one of the funniest voicemail messages last week, 855-411-JILL. Remember, we had the woman on who was like the neuro-ophthalmologist and Storoni, Mitu Storoni, and she was talking about how when you're talking to somebody, your pupils will actually sort of get in sync and they become the same size. And one of our voicemail messages from right after that show was, how can I look at my son's pupil and tell if, wait, how can I look at his pupil and tell if my teenage son is lying to me? That's a good question. There's a question for me too. We'll have to check that out. If you have not heard that show, that was a great show, by the way. You can hop on to our YouTube channel, just search Jill Schlesinger, or you know what Mark has done, which is really fab? He put a link right up on the website. So if you go to jillonmoney.com, it's great. Who is Jill? Better Off Podcast. You can get our podcast there, the blog, radio, TV, speaking. Boom, YouTube. You click on YouTube, and miraculously, you are led to our YouTube page where you can basically see everything that we're doing. So, like, you can look and say, hey, episode 340, Stress Proof, Being More Resilient Every Day. Or you can see the CFP Tip of the Week, which I do every week. Or you can listen to one of my favorite podcasts, the episodes that we've done since the beginning with Kathy O'Neill, Weapons of Math Destruction. Anyway, check it out. Just go to jillonmoney.com. Click on the YouTube link and you can figure it out right then and there. All right, here is a question that we receive from Katie. Katie writes, my husband and I are dedicated listeners. We love the show. Our question is, how much should we be trying to reduce our tax bracket by balancing our pre- and post-tax contributions to keep us in a lower tax bracket? We're 26 years old. We live in the Detroit area. He makes $90,000. I make about $94,000. I also get bonuses and overtime. Combined income, about $200,000. We each have 401k options through work, both traditional and Roth. We're both maxing out. By the way, they're 26. You got this, Mark? 26. They make $200,000. They're both maxing out $18,000. They split it evenly between the Roth and the traditional. We currently have $166,000 in our 401k, $62,000 in a money market account. We're saving that for property for our future home. We currently own a home with a mortgage, and when we have kids, I plan to take a few years off and then go back to work. I would appreciate the feedback if we should maximize our pre-tax contributions to keep us in a lower tax bracket or if we should keep it balanced with some Roth. Thanks, Katie. Katie, I like what you're doing. I think that, you know, I don't know what each of you does for a living, but I love the idea of having some chunk of money that has already been taxed. And we talked about this on the podcast and on the radio show a lot, because when the Roth was introduced, you know, I think it's like 20 years ago now, the main beat on this was, if you're young and you don't make a lot of money, you should use a Roth, but everyone else should use a traditional. The thought being that, you know, you pay your tax, you use an after-tax dollar today when your tax bracket is low, and chances are in the future it's going to go up. But I really started to rethink that advice from, you know, the two decades ago, because what I've learned is that a lot of people, as they come into retirement, face a really big liability because all of that money in a retirement account has yet to be taxed. And those required minimum distributions can be something that is hard to juggle later in life. So I love the idea that you have a bunch of money that's already been taxed. And, you know, of course, we don't know what's happening with tax law. We don't know how it's going to change. But what we do know is chances are, given the trajectory of the country's finances, that we know that we're going to probably see higher tax rates going forward. Not this second, just in general, that I think tax rates are likely to rise. So that said, I think it's great to have some money that's already been taxed. And even if everything stayed exactly the same, it is certainly nice not to have to be driven by when the government is forcing you to take money out of an account. So that I like. So I think keep doing what you're doing. I guess that, you know, I know that there's an idea about a lower tax bracket, but I'm not sure it makes a ton of sense to do it that way. Let me just check where the tax bracket breaks off, because I, of course, have to remember these things, but I don't. Okay, taxable income, married filing jointly. Well, you're not going to, I mean, if you're in the 28% now, you'd have to be under, you'd have to, that, so the break is at 153,000. So I don't know if you're going to get down there. Okay, so maybe just keep doing what you're doing. All right, that's good. I love these. I love these Roth versus traditional. It's like a way to control your destiny a lot more, with a lot more thoughtfulness than we probably knew about even just 10 years ago. So great question. Thanks, Katie. You're listening to Jill on Money. If you've got a financial question, we'd love to hear from you. 855-411-JILL. We'll get you on the air live. Go to jillonmoney.com. You can check out our stuff, or you can always send us an email, askjill@jillonmoney.com. We'll be right back.
Annuities, IRAs, 401ks, she covers it all. Back to Jill on Money with Jill Schlesinger. Let me
out, don't tell me. You're back with Jill on Money. If you've got a financial question, if you have an investment question, if you have a tax question, why don't you give us a holler? 855-411-JILL. If you are a regular listener of the program, we have a follow-up question to last week's show. John in Chicago had called in, and I gave him a couple of answers about how he and his fiance ought to be thinking about managing their money together. And so two pieces of this. One is that if you have a financial question, just give us a call, 855-411-JILL. But if you want to follow up with an email, askjill@jillonmoney.com. Isn't that easy to do? And then we can help you out. The thing that was kind of fun about the call with John was that he had said that his dad was one of the people who very much influenced him in his financial life. And his father, who is a CPA, encouraged him to save money with individual stocks and individual bonds. Now, I like individual bonds. Don't get me wrong. I like individual bonds very much. They work well. But, you know, for someone... I don't really think that most people are interested in being stock pickers. I think that statistically, it really is better for people to be using index funds. I am not alone in that. If you remember that Warren Buffett, my friends, actually had said in one of his annual letters, I think it was back in earlier this year in the spring, he basically has said that picking individual stocks or hiring someone to pick individual stocks is sort of a fool's errand. He really believes that the best thing that people can do is use an index fund. And I think that that's something is... We always think there's like a, we think there's a wizard behind the curtain. And when you hear somebody like Warren Buffett, who is a stock picker, say that in his letter to shareholders that it is really important that you try to stick with low-cost index funds. This is the quote I love. When trillions of dollars are managed by Wall Streeters who charge high fees, it will usually be the managers who reap outside profits, not the clients. And here's my favorite part. Both large and small investors should stick with low-cost index funds. Okay. So maybe that's something that you can share with your dad, John. If it's good enough to for Warren Buffett and his heirs, by the way, maybe good enough for you too. In terms of how you approach your soon-to-be wife about trying to think about her own retirement account and how she manages it, I think that having her be in a target date fund is perfectly reasonable. And that probably, she may not realize that in that target date fund, she has essentially taken on some risk. Maybe one cool way to bring this topic up in general is to say to her, you know, oh, I talked to this woman on the radio and, you know, she had some suggestions about my own retirement accounts and how my father had been suggesting we manage money. And then maybe have a sit down and just say, so let's look at what's in your target date fund. Let's make sure it's what you think it is. Let's make sure it has the risk profile that makes you feel comfortable. Blame me is, I guess, what I'm saying. Bring the topic up by saying that we spoke. And people who are really conservative with their money, you know, especially young people, you guys are not even 30 yet, that's, you know, it doesn't feel like it's as dangerous as taking on too much risk, but it can be dangerous to not take enough risk. One of the big issues around how millennials invest, we've been kind of keeping track of that, is that they seem to have a strange split. Some of them take a ton of risk. Like they just have all their money in stocks and or they're very comfortable having their entire retirement account in company stock. But there's a whole other group who are very risk averse. Maybe they saw their parents go through bad stuff or they graduated into the financial crisis. It can have a long lasting impact. A lot of those people are not taking a lot of risk. In fact, they have a lot of money in their cash accounts inside their retirement accounts. Those people also are taking risk. So how do we what's our big takeaway here? Our big takeaway is that you really need to have a conversation where you are trying to figure out what's the best approach for both of you. You are having these conversations, which is great. And if you get any pushback, but resistance, let's get her on the phone. Let's talk. I'll be the one who can talk to her. And I can be the person who says, hey, you know what? Let's think of this a slightly different way. I am more than happy to do that. Truly more than happy to do that. So give us a holler. How's that sound? We are full service here for John and his family. We want him on. We want his future wife on. We want his father on. Maybe we should get his mother on too. I think it's good though. I think they're having good he's having good conversations. All right. By the way, if you missed last week's show, just go to the YouTube channel and check it out. Search Jill Schlesinger. You can hear John's question. 855-411-JILL. That's our phone number. Email us, askjill@jillonmoney.com. We'll be right back. You're back with Jill on Money. If you have a financial question, we would love to hear from you. Our phone number here is 855-411-JILL. You can always email us, askjill@jillonmoney.com. All right. Judy writes, I'm about to turn 70 and a half. What is the deal with required minimum distributions? What is the deal? That's too funny. All right, here we go. So when you turn, after you've turned 70 and a half, this is the point when you have to start taking annual payments from any tax-sheltered retirement account. That would include an IRA, a simple IRA, a SEP IRA. You may also have to do it for your 401k or your 403b. So the issue is that the reason why this has to happen is the government wants to make sure that it gets starts collecting the tax money that's due, right? Because you have not paid taxes on this. And for so the big question I always get is like, oh, how do you figure this out? Oh, what's that noise? It was weird. And the answer is that for most people, your withdrawal, your mandatory withdrawal will be at about 3.6% of assets. As you start, that number will go up with age. The percentage applies to your asset value based on the preceding December 31st. So if you're taking out a withdrawal this year, Judy, for 2017, this withdrawal will be based on the amount of money that was in the account as of December 31st, 2016. And most IRA sponsors now will do this all for you. They're required actually to compute the amount for you. They can always make mistakes. The Internal Revenue Service actually has a table and also has a little calculator to figure it out. And just remember, if you don't take it out, it's bad. It's really bad. So please do take it out, because otherwise you're going to get penalty and fees. It's horrible. So take your required minimum distributions. Thanks for writing, Judy. All right, Jill on Money, 855-411-JILL. Send an email. Ask Jill at jillonmoney.com. We'll be right back.
It's the weekend, which means it's time for Jill on Money, the show that makes money fun and just happens to answer all your financial questions. Here's your host, Jill Schlesinger.
Welcome to Jill on Money. It's hour number two. So happy you are joining us. It is back to school time. Now that means, you know what? You got to do something, meaning you got to talk to your kids about money. And we have the perfect guest to help you with that journey. Beth Kobliner, she is the author of Make Your Kid a Money Genius, Even If You're Not. This is a guide for parents to teach kids their money basics, no matter what your own income level is. So many people who have money,
right,
who've really done pretty well in their lives, can't communicate with their kids. Why do you think that is?
I think that if you're in the financial world, or you're in a job that is overwhelming and taking all of your time, like most of us are, you're too busy. Or you feel like, you know what, I know corporate finance, but when it comes to where to put my savings, where do I open an IRA, I give it to my broker, I don't even know. So I think it's really important for parents of all income levels, but I find often upper middle income families are just either clueless, or they haven't had the time, or they're fearful. You know, often people are fearful just talking about, something I'm not sure I know. We know about the facts of life. We know we have to talk to kids about drugs and alcohol. We really do as kids age. But there's no script for talking about money. And I really wanted to write something that went through ages, whether you're age 3, whether you're in middle school, whether you're in high school or beyond, when your kid's graduating and sitting on your couch or sleeping on your couch back home. I think it's important to have these conversations.
This book, obviously, to me, not to everyone who's listening, is born out of your experience in the working with the Obama administration to create this website. Can you talk a little bit about that?
Right. So I was on this council, and sometimes councils sort of think big thoughts but don't move things along. And I wanted to do something to speak to parents and do the research to figure out what are the 3 or 4 things you need to teach parents to teach their kids when kids are very, very young, we know all the research on delayed gratification. Is it possible to teach it? And what can you do to do that? And how does that key into saving? When you're a little kid and you want something, it's very powerful if you say, you save up every week, every few days for that thing you want, and 2 months from now, you'll be able to get it. That is extremely powerful. And all those lessons came out in this website called Money As You Grow, which 1.5 million people came to, which was crazy.
I must have come a million times myself. I love that.
You.
I used it all the time. And I want to tell you why I used it, because I'm often asked this question about how do I talk to my kids about money? I've done television segments. We referenced it. We've had like beautiful slides of the whole thing.
Thank you.
And here's the beautiful thing about it in my mind is that Beth actually created it. Because I remember the first time you came on, I'm like, who did this for you? Because I did it.
I did it.
You did the whole
thing.
And
as a journalist, you sort of go in there and say, this is what we need to do. And everybody signed on, including the president, and thought it was a great, start to having those. And I remember he said, people are hungry for this information, and we know that. And I think there are so many small things people can do that just gets their kids on the right track, even if you don't understand finance, because my book is make your kid a money genius, even if you're not.
And I think you don't have to be a genius.
No.
But the book starts out with by the way, I totally violated this. I just did this for you. But read what I've highlighted on your first page.
The idea here is to put down the highlighter and just read. I know, because when I read books, I take books and I underline. I'm like, just relax with this chapter. This one chapter starts off with the basics of what, having the conversation, when to have the conversation, how to handle your own financial baggage and not get all stressed out about it.
And so, I think that number one, I like the idea where you say start earlier than you think you should.
Yeah. Well, research shows that by age 3, a kid understands basic financial concepts like exchange or value. And I don't know if you remember, a couple of years ago, I did something with Sesame Street and I got to teach Elmo about money. Well, that was really a fun experience. And really what I learned, and all their researchers there were saying, that this notion of starting early and getting to kids when they're still impressionable and can understand this is huge. We know so much about brain plasticity and how when kids are young, starting to talk about delaying gratification. And the other frightening study came out from Cambridge University in England that by age 7, kids are really locked into most of their financial traits, that executive function they talk about. So you've really got to start this at 3, 4, 5, 6 to start kids thinking in the right way.
The other part of this, which I learned only with TV, this is one of the few things I've learned working in TV.
Uh-huh.
Use anecdotes.
Oh my goodness. It comes alive. My mom taught me that, right? But now the research shows that if you give a specific story, and I always talk about when my dad came home in the 60s, he was a teacher, and he said to my mom, they had 3 kids and a mortgage, she said, we have to put half of my salary into the new 403B plan the city just started. And my mom said, we can't afford to, Harold. We have 3 kids. And my dad said, we can't afford not to. Mm-hmm. And that's how they started saving and saving and saving over 65 years of marriage and have had a very successful financial life and imparted it to their 3 children. Just those small lessons and those memories and those stories you remember can really make a difference. So talking to your kid about the time, I got into credit card debt, but I'm going to help you not do that.
But there is one thing that I thought was interesting, because I think a lot of parents get a little caught up in this, even when they're having the drug talk, right?
Yeah.
Which is, you don't want to lie about what has happened in your past,
mm-hmm.
right? So you
mm-hmm.
want to own up, like, I did get into credit card debt, even though, you look at mommy and she runs off to work and she makes a lot of money. She's got a big career
and we
live in a nice place and all that stuff.
Exactly.
So, and obviously there could be some shame associated with that, but you also say don't overshare either.
Right.
What do you mean about that?
The parents, we all have friends, not us, but friends who, went to Paris on a, cash advance and then had such an amazing time. And those are kind of fun stories that you might talk to your friends about. Remember that time? But in general, try to keep it age appropriate with your kids and don't glamorize, just like you wouldn't glamorize, you know, that drug experience in the 80s. You don't want to, you want to sort of give age appropriate advice and not lie. You also want to make sure your kid understands that I, you know, everybody makes some mistakes, but I'm going to help you not make mistakes. I'm going to talk this through. And I think the lying part happens often on the day-to-day basis. You walk into a store and your child says, can I have that, please, please? And you're like, ah, it's only $2, whatever. But actually, the ability to say no to your kid is helpful to your child, not only because it's good for them to hear no, but also because research shows that if you always give it to a child at the checkout counter, chances are they will have more credit card debt in college.
Wow. We'll get back to our interview with Beth Kobliner in just a moment. If you've got a financial question, give us a holler, 855-411-JILL. Send us an email, askjill@jillonmoney.com. We'll be right back.
Annuities, IRAs, 401ks, she covers it all. Back to Jill on Money with Jill Schlesinger. Let me out,
don't tell me everything. You're back with Jill on Money. If you've got a financial question, give us a call. Our number here is 855-411-JILL. Send us an email, askjill@jillonmoney.com. One question that we often get here on the program has to do with building a responsible child. How does one do that? And a lot of people ask about the concept of allowances. I didn't get an allowance, so that's always it's always a little bit of a strange topic for me. But people go back and forth on this one. And if you're going back and forth, I've got good news, because we have a terrific guest, Beth Kobliner. She is the author of Make Your Kid a Money Genius, Even If You're Not. You may have heard of Beth because she wrote a New York Times bestseller called Get a Financial Life, Personal Finance in Your 20s and 30s. I like that she kind of went back and said, wait, 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 20s and 30s might be too late. We've got to start talking to our kids about money right now. But it's really interesting because, again, the world is sort of split. Do you pay kids for doing chores? Should they just do that as being a responsible family member? Let's find out. Beth Kobliner, she joins us here at the Jill on Money Show. Tell me about allowance, because I think that we talk a lot about money with our kids, and this is a way to do it. What is your opinion about the allowance issue?
Well, it's interesting because there's so much written about allowance. And finally, I said, just being the kind of nerdy researcher I am, looked at all the research. There were dozens of studies, some, you know, done in England and Canada and all over the world, actually. And the bottom line with allowances, it doesn't really matter, which you knew, your parents were smart enough to figure out. And my parents, I didn't get an allowance either. So the most important thing is to be consistent. That's all that matters. Like, remember that marshmallow test, the thing where you give a kid a marshmallow, and then if you don't come back, if they eat it right away, they're going to fail their SATs. But if they wait, you know, that whole benefit of waiting.
Yep.
Well, they redid the test recently, and they found when the person giving you the marshmallow didn't come back for a really long time and then came back without the marshmallow, the kid was devastated. So you, as a parent, if you say, look, we're not going to buy this until you save up enough money, and then you come, you know, a few weeks later, you're like, oh, my poor kid, I want to get it for him, that's a mistake. So parents have to be consistent. But don't worry if, I know so many parents are like, ah, I'm so guilty, I started an allowance system, and then 3 months later, we stopped doing it, and my kid forgot to ask, and I forgot to pay, and forget it. Just be consistent, have set rules, what you'll pay for, what your kid could expect. We started the allowance when our kids entered college. Then we really became much more, you pay for all this, and this is your decision. If you want to go with friends to a skiing trip, that's on you. And man, are they good now at looking for coach flights.
Ah, very good.
Figuring out to take the train to Maine, not a plane. It's very interesting to me how that has such an impact. But when they're older, when they're in college.
Okay, so you know, the book is great, and it sort of brings you through age, you know, age-appropriate conversations,
right,
different ways to start conversations. There are some things that you have early on here about things you don't need to tell your kids about money. And so this is very funny to me because, remember, my dad was a trader on Wall Street, right?
Right.
So what happened was he did talk about, like, mm-hmm, money that he made or didn't make, mm, because that was what his day was.
Right,
so daddy came home from work. My mother would say, how'd we do?
Yeah, I understand.
Okay, but you say...
My mother did that with my test. How'd you do?
Right, exactly. Oh, only a 98. What happened to the other 2 points?
Exactly.
I bet you were a 98 kind of gal. What about salary? Should you tell your kids about your salary or not?
No, it's silly. I mean, honestly... I'm sure your dad didn't come home and say, hey, we made $100,000 today, or oh, we lost $2 million, you know. First of all, it's not appropriate for children for a variety of reasons. Kids get worried. Kids get nervous. Does that mean, you know, no context? I have to say, I've gone around the country talking about this issue for literally 30 years. And my son, when he was 5 years old, he got all worried about not having health insurance because I would talk about health insurance. I'm like, don't worry, honey. You know, kids take things out of context. So use judgment. You don't have to put all your money out there. You can talk about what's the median income in our country. And you know what? We're doing really well. We work really hard and we're very lucky. But no need for numbers now because, you know, frankly, you're going to hear it at parent-teacher conferences when you show up and they're like, oh, how's your hedge fund doing? You know, you just you don't need to get into that depth with a 7-year-old.
Okay. Let's talk a little bit about maybe teenagers, mm-hmm, because there's the other thing you say you shouldn't share with your child is how much you worry about paying for college. Because obviously a lot of people here listening are saving for retirement. They're making good livings. Life is good.
Right.
And maybe they are a little bit nervous about paying for college. Maybe they make too much money to get any
financial
sort of aid.
Yeah.
And so there's that sense like, oh, my God, you know, we make a few $100,000 a year, which is an awesome living,
right,
and we're really doing
right
well. But I don't know if I can pay for college. How am I
right
going to do that?
And which college? And could it be my dream college or my college I went to? It's so overwhelming for people. And I think that the most important thing is for a parent to get knowledge. Start in 9th grade. I have a whole chapter in Make Your Kid a Money Genius about college, how to see how much financial aid you possibly could get, what are things to think about your finances now. If you put all your money in your kid's name, you're going to get less aid. Those kind of issues. But overall, starting in 9th grade, saying, you know what, we know we're going to be in as a team. We're going to get you to a good college. As a parent, it's your responsibility. Do your research now. Just look at the forms. See what you're going to be asked. It's not fun. Let's put it this way. I mean, no one finds filling out the financial aid form fun, but it could be fruitful for parents of many broad age ranges, especially if you have a couple of kids. But thinking about that now takes the elephant out of the room. Otherwise, you know, it's sort of trendy now in schools to say, shh, don't talk about college. But kids know. There's so much stress.
Of course they do.
So talk about it up front, saying, we're in this together. We're gonna figure this out. And by the way, grades in 9th grade count. Not to make them crazy about it, but just to pay attention. And, you know, every year have this conversation and work it through. Because I know so many people, I don't know if you do, Jill, but so many people who got into a dream college and their parents said, oops, sorry, we don't have the money to pay for it.
Yeah, we want to have that conversation before. I agree with
exactly
you, because you can't, you know, if you say, if you're going to let the kid apply to the dream college, you're kind of on the hook with them. And that's not a great place to be.
My parents gave me the choice, Queens College, I'm from Queens, or Brown.
That was your two choices?
Those were my choices. Or Harvard, which I didn't get into, and Yale.
Oh, you know what? I hate those two.
But I got into Brown, and it changed my life. And they said, we're going to scrimp and save and send you there because it's, to us, this seems like, for them, the American dream.
Right.
And it was for me an American dream. Otherwise, I wouldn't have met you.
We might have met anyway. But I think it was destiny for sure.
Yes.
One of the things that's happened in the especially since the financial crisis,
right,
is this concept of the boomerang kid.
Mm.
And I noticed this, like, I don't have kids, everyone, so I'm just coming clean here. So I noticed this with my sister.
Them?
No, you got, you, yours are good. But, you know, my sister, I have nieces and nephews,
right,
and I know that, you know, both, you know, through marriage and et cetera, we have a lot of nieces and nephews, and you see that those kids stay on the parents' payroll for a lot longer. And
right,
the kids, especially in sort of upper middle class
absolutely
households, because the smart. Parents can.
The parents can, and they're like, well, why wouldn't I? You know, it used to be, I think, in our day, I'm not going to move back home.
Exactly. There was a shame factor.
Yeah, there was a shame. Who would do? I did move back home because I had $10,000 in student loans, so I lived at home for my mom. First, my mom was said, when I called her, I'm like, I'm going to move out. She's like, no, you're not. And then she called back, okay, you can move out. Do you have money to move out? And I'm like, oh, I don't have money.
Okay, I had a different conversation. I was moving to the city, and I took a job with a trading firm, and they said, well, you know, we'll put you out, you'll be controlling, you'll be actually a trader faster, but your initial salary was $15,000 a year. Thank you, Spirulitz and Kellogg. And I said to my father, well, I'm only going to make $15,000 because it's a better job. Don't take that stupid job at, I think, Shearson, was I was offered a job. And he said, I said, how am I going to pay my rent? Right. He looked at me and goes, I guess you have to sell your car. And he would not pay my rent.
Yeah,
and
good
I was
for
like,
him.
And so I did. I sold my car.
Good for you. Well, you know, I mean, to have a car in New York City is quite the luxury.
I know, but it was going to sit at my parents' house in Westchester anyway.
You wanted it was smart.
We'll get back with our interview of Beth Kobliner in just a second. If you need some help and how to talk to your kids about money, come on, we'll help you out. Mark and I don't have kids. We're the perfect ones to ask. 855-411-JILL. You can always send us an email, askjill@jillonmoney.com. We'll be right back.
Young, old, it doesn't matter. She's here to help you. Back to Jill on Money with Jill Schlesinger.
You're back with Jill on Money, and we are talking about kids and money. Now, we've been chatting a lot about what to do with your younger kids. You pay them an allowance or not, and how do you talk to them? But I have to say that the trend of the boomerang kid, the kids graduating from college, coming to live home again, or maybe an adult child who runs into a problem, it is very thorny. It is very difficult to navigate that particular issue because the kid's an adult, but they need to live home and you want to help them out. And what are the best practices for doing that? How do you manage that process? Well, luckily, we've got a great guest, Beth Kobliner. She's the author of the New York Times bestseller, Make Your Kid a Money Genius, Even If You're Not. She's weighing in on that. These kids are coming home, or they're living in the city where they do have a good job, but the job isn't enough to really support them.
Exactly.
What is the conversation you have with your kids around that period of time?
It's funny. A very, very, very wealthy man, whose name I won't mention, called me the other day and said, Beth, what would you do if I have two kids out of college, two in college? What should I do with them about money? And I'm like, whoa. And I basically said that be realistic. Think about if you have enough money that you want to give out some sort of monthly allowance to your kid, I'm not opposed to it. Because let's face it, if you have a lot of money and your kid is living on, you know, Avenue C or D, you know, it's hard for that if you don't feel comfortable, if they're safe. I don't know. Avenue C must be great now.
Yeah, exactly. Mark,
like,
wait a minute.
Sorry, Mark. Avenue C. Well, in our day, right?
Right,
Avenue
right. Alphabet City, you'd be
Alphabet
like,
City.
Okay, you're going to die.
Now it's probably like I couldn't even afford it.
Right.
So, but when you're talking to your kids, think about what you want out of it. Like, do you want them to live in an area that you feel comfortable with? You know, I'm so out of it, Mark. Like, do you not want them to live all the way deep into Bayside, Queens, where I grew up? So if you don't want that and you feel like that's something that's important to you, think of a realistic number. How much do rents really cost? How much? And then give them a number and say, you know what? This amount, if you could afford it again, you're not obligated to do this, but this amount is what you need to do all your spending with.
Mm-hmm.
If you go out to dinner, if you do something else, if you... This is your money, and it is amazing how that lesson teaches kids to scrimp, save. Well, maybe I won't go out to dinner with these friends. Maybe I'll just have coffee with that friend. You know, that's the basic. Now, if you don't have gobs and gobs of money, then I think it is perfectly fine to have a conversation with your kid, and at that point, you don't want to tell them, you don't even need to tell them your exact income, but you could. And you can say, look, we still have the same home. We still have, you know, we're worried about, of course, long-term medical expenses. And we've designed our finances so that we will hopefully be able to take care of ourselves so we're not a burden to you. Hmm. But your job now as a college-educated, super smart kid is to figure this out And again, if there's amount you can give them regularly, do it. But this sort of one-off here, one-off here, it creates so much tension and stress and pressure. I think, again, from age 3 to 23, it's the consistency and talking about it openly, but not crazily. And let's face it, you do not owe your kids a living. Remember that expression?
Yeah.
You owe me a living? You really don't.
Right.
That's their responsibility.
If you're somebody who is, you know, mid-career and you haven't had a conversation, you missed the first few years. So let's just say that, you know, I'm 38 years old.
Uh-huh.
And I've,
you
know,
look 38.
Oh,
amazing.
God bless you, baby. Unfortunately, you actually know how old I am. And, you know, you are married and you got a couple kids and they're in middle school.
Right.
And you really, can you go back? In other words, what happens if you had, like, they're listening to us, Beth, and someone's saying, like, darn it, where was Beth when I needed her 10 years ago? Now my kid's 13, 14, 15. What should I do?
Right. You can always address this at different points. And I think that's probably the most important takeaway from this book is, and that's why I really divided it easily into chunks, that if you have a middle schooler and you're flashing the credit card and your kid very likely thinks that a credit card is a better way of paying for something than cash. I hear more and more stories of parents saying, my kid said, don't pay for that, just use your card. Like, they don't understand that a card or buying something online is actually paying money. If you have that kid, that's the conversation to have. And you wouldn't talk to, you know, a middle schooler and say, ooh, let's save your pennies for that, you know, Lego kit you want. But then you start talking about, okay, let's think about what your major expenses are. And we're going to start talking about this. And we're going to open a bank savings account. And you have a super ambitious kid, I say by 16, and your kid is working and has some income, put it into a Roth IRA. Roth IRA, 16, 17, 18, it's a smart way for that kid. Even if they leave it there and never touch it again until they're 30, it's going to be a lot of money.
I think you were the one who told me this concept about a Roth when your kid's working.
Yes.
And that you said the other thing you can do is you can actually match. You can basically do a parental match. I love this concept, which is like, I want to encourage you to do this. And ergo, I'm also going to show you what a match is about.
As long as they make enough, you know, with the Roth IRA, they have to earn $2,000. But if they spend $1,000 of that, you can put in another $1,000 to be, that's your $2,000 in your Roth IRA. And that is so empowering. I think at any age, a parent can empower a child. I mean, your mother, I'm sure, like all our parents can tell us when to right, tell us when to wrong. They're usually not afraid to do so.
Maybe. Yeah. No.
And I think
this is a Jewish mother thing. I don't know. Beth and I have that similar mothers that don't hold back.
But I think that there are different stages and different ways, whether your kid is typing in your credit card or absentmindedly giving them your number, they're typing it in and just ordered $400 worth of toys and you didn't realize it. Or your child is 17, 18, 19, and they get a credit card and suddenly they get a credit score that's problematic. Talking to your kid about what this credit score is, your reputation for many, many, many years. How do we implant that on kids' head? Or you're getting student loans, get federal Stafford loans if you qualify, or the unsubsidized Staffords, don't get the private student loans. All those conversations are so important. And I think there are teachable moments no matter what age your kid is, and there are financial facts of life, you know, points that you can help a kid. And the reason I say money genius, honestly, it's the basic stuff people know. The magic of compounding, how to put your money in a tax-free basis to something like a Roth IRA, how to avoid high-rate credit card debt, because if you're paying a 16% rate, that's the equivalent of earning 16% on your money guaranteed after taxes. That's a good investment, so pay off that high-rate debt. All those, you know, important lessons, but it's sort of given throughout the book in age-appropriate ways.
Well, thanks so much to Beth Kobliner, the author of Make Your Kid a Money Genius. She's also the author of Get a Financial Life, Personal Finance in Your 20s and 30s. Check out her website if you have any questions about Beth. BethKobliner.com. You're listening to Jill on Money. If you've got a question, 855-411-JILL. Send us an email. Ask Jill at JillOnMoney.com. We'll be right back.
Young, old, it doesn't matter. She's here to help you. Back to Jill on Money with Jill Schlesinger. What have we done
with the innocence? You're back with Jill on Money. If you've got a financial question, 855-411-JILL. Send us an email, askjill@jillonmoney.com. Hey, Mark, you want to hear something funny? Our friendly weatherman from WCBS-TV, John Elliott, comes up to me in the hallway early this morning, and he's like, I heard your show is like in the middle of the country, and I was on vacation or visiting family. And he says, I heard the show. It's so great. He says, is that Dave Barrett voicing the show? I said, yes, it is. CBS News' own Dave Barrett. Isn't that funny? A little inside baseball. Anyway, he's a friend of ours. I don't know how we got. I think that we just, did we give him dinner, lunch last year? We got to do that again. I know we got to do that again, though. Make sure he knows that he's still getting well compensated for that voiceover work. Paul wrote us that he bought both of his kids, who are now 27 and 24, Beth Kobliner's book, Get a Financial Life. It was awesome. They learned a ton. They still use it as a reference. That's so wonderful. I love that. We love Beth. She's amazing. Also, for those of you interested, because this is really the time of year where your kids are back in school, I think another great book of Beth's, Make Your Kid a Money Genius. Even if you're not, it's a guide for parents to teach kids money basics. And it's fantastic. We've had her on the show. But just in case you haven't talked to your kids about money recently, I would do that. Okay. All right. Diane had a question about reverse mortgages. Are there monthly charges that are added to the mortgages? To these mortgages, when my mom had a reverse mortgage, the fees added up each month to where the mortgage almost doubled. I'm just wondering. You know, there are tons of fees on these reverse mortgages. But what I should note is, since I wrote that article, early August, maybe, I think. Anyway, the end of August, HUD announced changes to the reverse mortgage program. So this is what the deal is. Okay. The program itself, there were some improvements that have been made. The problem is that this is a program that has a lot of volatile pieces of it. So remember, so let me just go back. Reverse mortgages are for older people. I was going to say seniors, but now I feel like as I get closer to being a senior, I don't want to use that word. So for older people who are 62 and older, they still live in their home. It allows them to withdraw a portion of their home's equity. So it's pretty cool. It lets you tap some money. The loans don't need to be paid off until the borrower dies, sells the house, or moves. Okay. But the administration is making changes to put the program, which is obviously backstopped by taxpayers, on stronger financial footing. And here is how. New borrowers will pay bigger premiums up front, but lower ones over the life of the loan. So that is just going to hopefully lessen the risk to taxpayers, I guess. That's a longevity risk, right? We want some money up front. Borrowers will now pay 2% of the amount of the home's value up front. 2% of the amount of the home's value up front, 0.5% annually. Right now, borrowers pay 0.5% up front and 1.25% annually over the loan. Okay? So the bottom line on reverse mortgages going forward is that most seniors will likely be able to borrow less money. Okay? So for some reason, that has, I don't know, these mortgages are tough, these reverse mortgages. But the changes are designed to prevent the taxpayer from having to fund a lot of the loans that go south, or, you know, for folks who didn't pay enough and live too long, all those pieces. Okay. So the changes are, they're not, I don't know if they're in, they're, I don't think they're in, they're not necessarily in use right now. They're just saying we're developing these changes. They plan to change this. So raising premiums, a little bit less loan amount that you can get. All right. So there it is. I guess I'm going to have to write yet another reverse mortgage story. I can't do it so quickly. Federal employee wants to know, went with a financial planner a year ago, moved her money to an annuity and stocks. And now she's terrified after reading an annuity, my blog on annuity. She's terrified. Refer me to a second opinion. Okay, I don't know where you are. Get a fee-only financial planner. Go to NAPFA, NAPFA.org, NAPFA.org. Put your zip code in. See if you can get a fee-only planner. If not, or if you live in a place where there are not enough financial planners, shoot us a note. Let us know where you are. Maybe we know someone who can help you out. Chances are, if you moved this money just a year ago and you bought an annuity, it may not be all may not be lost. Maybe it's a low-cost annuity. Who knows? But let's find out where you are and help you get some answers to whether or not you need to make any changes right this moment. Okay, when we return, more of your questions. It's Jill on Money, 855-411-JILL. Send us an email, askjill@jillonmoney.com. We'll be right back. You're back with Jill on Money. I'm sorry, I was almost choked as I said that, and I'm not exactly sure why, except to say that this is the beauty of live radio. If you've got a financial question, give us a holler. Our phone number here is 855-411-JILL. Send us an email, askjill@jillonmoney.com. David writes, I bought a $920,000 house 2.5 years ago. We have a $700,000 mortgage. We have made a big mistake. The house is too big. We are very unhappy with the remoteness of our location. Want to move closer to town, but scared I'm going to get hammered selling. Maybe the house has appreciated a tiny bit, but let's say it hasn't. Should we just suck it up and stay where we are? It's a 5,000 square foot house. We would be fine with 3,500 square feet. But we know we're going to incur big costs to sell it and actually to move. What is your advice? Should we rent? Should we bite the bullet? Should we stay where we are? I am not a fan of staying in a place where you're not happy. That's number one. I'm certainly not a fan in staying in a place that probably costs more to maintain, has higher property taxes, and you know, it's just not going to be a place where you want to live. So my number one piece of advice is, first of all, let's find out what you really can sell this thing for. And let's pretend that it's the exact same amount you paid for it. And let's pretend it's going to cost you, I don't know, 75, 80 grand to get out of this mistake. Okay, get out. That's what I have to say. Now, the question about renting versus owning is a very different question, because I think what you're trying to say is, I'm going to read between the lines, is that you don't want to feel like you have to hurry up and actually find something. Fine to rent for a year, not a problem. But remember, interest rates could rise. Probably not going to go up by 5%, but you know, you could be facing a little bit of a pain point on that. But that doesn't mean just go do it. So I hope that helps. Give us a holler back if you need more assistance. And thanks, everyone, for listening. It's been a great program. To our listeners of the Jewish faith, have a happy Rosh Hashanah. And we will talk to you next week. It's 855-411-JILL. Send us an email, askjill@jillonmoney.com. We'll see you next week.